Hi everybody, today is September 11th, 2013. NSA shares raw intelligence, including Americans' data, with Israel. Secret deal placed no legal limits on use of data by Israelis. Only official U.S. government communications protected. Agency insists it complies with rules governing privacy. The National Security Agency routinely shares raw intelligence with Israel, without first shifting to remove information about U.S. citizens. A top-secret document provided to The Guardian by whistleblower Edward Snowden reveals. Details of the intelligence sharing agreement are laid out in a memorandum of understanding between the NSA and its Israeli counterpart that shows that the U.S. government handed over intercepted communications likely to contain phone calls and emails of American citizens. The agreement places no legal binding limits on the use of the data by the Israelis. The disclosure that the NSA agreed to provide raw intelligence data to a foreign country contrasts with assurance from the Obama administration that there are rigorous safeguards to protect the privacy of U.S. citizens caught in the dragnet. The intelligence community calls this process minimization, but the memorandum makes clear that the information shared with the Israelis would be in its pre-miniaturized state. The deal was reached in principle in March of 2009, according to an updated memorandum, which lays out the ground rules for the intelligence sharing. The five-page memorandum, termed an agreement between the U.S. and Israeli intelligence agencies pertaining to the protection of U.S. persons, repeatedly stressed the constitutional rights of Americans to privacy and the need for Israeli intelligence staff to respect these rights. But this is undermined by the disclosure that Israel is allowed to receive raw signal intelligence. The memorandum says raw signal includes, but is not limited to, unevaluated, unminimized transcripts, GIFs, facsimiles, telex, voice and digital network intelligence, metadata, and content. According to the agreement, the intelligence being shared would not be filtered in advance by NSA analysis to remove U.S. communications. NSA routinely sends ISNU, the Israeli Signet National Unit, minimized and unminimized raw collection, it says. Although the memorandum is explicit in saying the material had to be handled in accordance with U.S. law, and that the Israelis agree not to deliberately target Americans identified in the data, these rules are not backed up by legal obligations. This agreement is not intended to create any legal enforcement rights and shall not be constituted to be either an international agreement or a legally binding instrument according to international law, the document says. In a statement to The Guardian, an NSA spokesman did not deny that personal data about Americans was included in raw intelligence data shared with the Israelis. But the agency insisted that the shared intelligence complied with all rules governing privacy. Any U.S. person information that is acquired as a result of NSA surveillance activities is handled under procedures that are designated to protect privacy rights, the spokesperson said. The NSA declined to answer specific questions about the agreement, including whether permission had been sought from the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance, FISA, court for handing over such material. The Memorandum of Understanding, which The Guardian is publishing in full, allows Israel to retain any files containing the identities of U.S. persons for up to a year. The agreement requests only that the Israelis should consult the NSA Special Liaison Advisor when such data is found. Notably, a much stricter rule was set for the U.S. government communications found in the raw intelligence. The Israelis were required to destroy upon recognition any communication that is either to or from an official of the U.S. government, but not U.S. citizens, evidently. Such communication included those of officials of the executive branch, including the White House, cabinet departments, and independent agencies. Also, the House of Representatives and Senate member and staff, and the U.S. federal court system, including but not limited to the Supreme Court. It is not clear whether any communications involving members of U.S. Congress or the federal courts have been included in the raw data provided by the NSA, nor is it clear how or why the NSA would be in possession of such communications. In 2009, however, the New York Times reported on the agency's attempt to wiretap a member of Congress without court approval on an overseas trip. The NSA is required by law to target only non-U.S. persons without an individual warrant, but it can collect the content and metadata of Americans' emails and calls without a warrant when such communication is with a foreign target. U.S. persons are defined in surveillance legislation as U.S. citizens, permanent residents, and anyone located on U.S. soil at the time of the interception, unless it's been positively established that they are not a citizen or permanent resident. Moreover, with much of the world's internet traffic passing through U.S. networks, large numbers of purely domestic communication also get scooped up, incidentally, by the agency's surveillance programs. The document mentions only one check carried out by the NSA on the raw intelligence, saying the agency will regularly review a sample of files transferred to ISNU to validate the absence of U.S. persons' identities. It also requests that the Israelis limit access only to personnel with a strict need to know. Israeli intelligence is allowed to disseminate foreign intelligence information concerning U.S. persons derived from raw signet by NSA on condition that it does so in a manner that does not identify the U.S. person. The agreement also allows Israel to release U.S. person identities to outside parties, including all INSU customers, with the NSA's written permission. Although Israel is one of America's closest allies, it is not one of the inner core of countries involved in surveillance sharing with the U.S., Britain, Australia, Canada, and New Zealand. This group is collectively known as Five Eyes. The relationship between the U.S. and Israel has been strained at times, both diplomatically and in terms of intelligence. In the top secret 2013 intelligence community budget request, details of which were disclosed by the Washington Post, Israel is identified alongside Iran and China as a target for U.S. cyber attacks. The reason it's so important for Israel to be protected and maintained is because they consider Israel the only stable country there in the Middle East. I did an article how the NSA is actually providing half of the expenses for the UK for their spying. While NSA documents tout the mutual benefit relationship of signet sharing, another report marked top secret and dated September 2007 states that the relationship, while central to U.S. strategy, has become overwhelmingly one-sided in favor of Israel. Balancing the signet exchange equally between U.S. and Israeli needs has been a constant challenge, states the report titled History of the U.S.-Israel Signet Relationship Post-1992. In the last decade, it arguably tilted heavily in favor of Israeli security concerns. 9/11 came and went with NSA's only true third-party counter-terrorism relationship being driven almost totally by the needs of the partner. In another top-secret document seen by The Guardian dated 2008, a senior NSA official points out that Israel aggressively spies on the U.S. On the one hand, the Israelis are extraordinarily good signet partners for us. But on the other, they target us to learn our position on Middle East problems, the official says. A NIE, National Intelligence Estimate, ranked them as the third most aggressive intelligence service against the U.S. Later in the document, the official is quoted as saying one of NSA's biggest threat is actually from friendly intelligence services like Israel. There are parameters on what NSA shares with them, but the exchange is so robust we sometimes share more than we intended. The Memorandum of Understanding also contains hints that there has been tensions in the intelligence sharing relationship with Israel. At a meeting in March of 2009 between the two agencies, according to the document, it was agreed that the sharing of raw data required a new framework and further training for Israeli personnel to protect U.S. person information. It was not clear whether or not this was because there had been a problem up to a point in the handling of intelligence that was found to contain America's data. However, an earlier U.S. document obtained by Snowden, which discussed cooperation on military intelligence program, bluntly lists under the cons trust issues which resolve around previous ISR Israeli operations. The Guardian asked the Obama administration how many times U.S. data has been found in the raw intelligence, either by the Israelis or when the NSA reviewed a sample of the files, but officials declined to provide this information. Nor would they disclose how many other countries the NSA shared raw data with, or whether the FISA court, which is meant to oversee NSA surveillance programs and the procedures to handle U.S. information, had signed off the agreement with Israel. In its statement, the NSA said, "We are not going to comment on any specific information sharing arrangements or the authority under which any such information is collected." The fact that intelligence services work together under specific and regulated conditions mutually strengthens the security of both nations. NSA cannot, however, use these relationships to circumvent U.S. legal restrictions. Whenever we share intelligence information, we comply with all applicable rules, including the rules to protect U.S. persons' information. Well, when Israel shares this personal information to second and third parties, that would be a good way of NSA getting around our constitutional laws, wouldn't it? All right, bookmark my site. I'll keep you up to date. Please stay safe, and I'll talk to you later. God bless you all. Bye.